Just like any unicycle, first we need to remove the foot plates before we can actually disassemble the M10-3. And we can do that with an Allen key or a hex key. After the foot plates are removed, then we can get onto the front and back panel of the M10-3. The panels are held by plastic clips, so we need to be careful when we remove it because we don't want to snap the clips. After we have removed the plastic covers, then we need to peel off the ankle padding because underneath we can see 6 screws that are holding the motor to the chassis. You may find a membrane, so you need to pierce it before you can have easier access to the screws. And also it's slightly annoying that the magnet that is used to hold the foot plates together sometimes also attracts the metal screw bit, which makes removing the top screws slightly more challenging. And similarly on the other side, we remove the 6 screws and now the motor is free from the chassis.
If you're watching this video, you might have an M10-3 and you might have a punctured tire, but we have some in stock, so definitely if you're after a tire, go to speedyfit.co.uk. Not only that, but we also have the Sherman tire in, so we have the off-road and the street tire. So if you have a Sherman and you're looking for a new tire, speedyfit.co.uk.
And there are 8 screws that you need to remove, 4 on one side of the M10-3 and 4 on the other. So after you remove these screws, then you want to peel off the LED light strip. So after removing the 12 motor screws and then the 8 screws holding the chassis together and peeling off the light strip, and then we can remove the side panel of the M10-3. Most likely there will be some extra resistance because there are some very sticky pads on either side of the battery pack and they hold the two chassis together. So be careful of that when you're separating the left and the right side panels. Because of the position of the motherboard, you don't really have easy access to the motor cables. So that's why we need to remove the screws that are holding the battery pack to the side panel. Some screws are holding the battery pack to the chassis, but then some screws are actually holding the two sides of the battery pack. So you just make sure that you undo only the screws that are linking the battery pack to the chassis. And again, the sticky pads get in the way because they're holding the battery pack to the other side panel, which makes it slightly tricky to separate the battery pack from the chassis. I found that one of the cables wasn't long enough, so that's why I also removed the rear panel. And then I unplugged the battery and drained the charge from the motherboard, just so I don't want any voltage in the board when I'm swapping parts and whatnot. Now I can start removing the motor cables, but I just need to make sure that I know where the yellow, green and blue cable goes, because you don't really want to mix them up when you put them back together. So you can just take a photo to remind yourself in which positions they go. And there is another plastic panel which is holding all the motor cables together, so I need to remove that one as well. Actually there are two, a big one and a small one. And with the screws removed, now we can safely separate the motor from the chassis. One thing that no one told me about was that because there was a puncture, the customer had put some slime into the tire. So when I was getting the air out, there was slime spatters everywhere. And then separating the tire from the motor, I saw so much green yuckiness that made the job not as pleasant as I was hoping for. And obviously I tried to figure out how to separate the tire from the motor without really making a massive mess. So I started cleaning the motor and even got some acetone so I can better clean the metal. And to be fair, after the cleanup, the motor looked nice and shiny. It's always satisfying when you're able to clean something. Now the next challenge was actually fitting the tire back onto the motor. That was really difficult because the tire, if you put one side in, then the other side didn't want to go. And then I was going in circles as I'm pushing part of the tire into the rim, then another part of the tire was beginning to stick out. So I called in a special reinforcement. So I got some help from Ian. So the trick is that you need to get the tire in at an angle and then you need to pinch the tire because then you get a bit more leeway when you're putting the tire onto the motor. It was a long and hard battle, but finally we were able to get the tire onto the rim. And this was pretty much the hardest bit. After that, it was just pretty straightforward. Putting all the pieces together, the screws and the cables, and obviously checking when I'm putting the cables into the motherboard, just to make sure that I have the right cables in the right sockets. If you keep a track of your screws and where they go, then it should be pretty straightforward to put everything back together. And then I reconnected the battery to the main board just to see if the wheel turns on. And it turns on, so that was a good sign. I have the green light to actually start putting the panels together. I slotted the top panel and then started putting all the screws in there. And then started screwing the motor screws. And then turning the wheel on the other side, and again installing the other 6 motor screws and the rest of the panel screws. And after all the screws are together, I just double checked if they're all nice and tight. And with the LED light strip back in its place, now I can put the front and the back panels onto the M10-3. You just need to use a little bit of pressure and then you can get the front and rear panels into place where the clips go. And when all of the panels are back together, now we can put the foot plates back onto the M10-3.
One of the things about the M10-3 tire is that there is a line here, just around the edge of the rim. Because the tube is tireless, it's very important that you get this line straight all around the rim. If the tire is twisted, that means that it cannot create a vacuum, so you cannot pump up air and fill up the tire. That's why it's very important when you put in the new tire, just to make sure that on both sides the line goes evenly alongside the rim. This is one of the caveats when you're working with a tubeless tires.
And when we have the foot plates on the M10-3, now the only thing that we can do is actually test the wheel, how it rides. And after a quick test, it rides perfectly fine. So I can definitely say that this was a successful job.